It's Ron Goodall on FightHype.com. I'm here with the world-renowned, one of the best in the boxing game, Coach Larry Wade. How's it going?
Hey, brother. How are you? Everything is well over here.
That's awesome. First and foremost, congrats with all the success that you have been doing from the start of the boxing game, even when you started out in your athletic field and
track
and field, now into boxing.
Yes.
How have you been able to take all these fighters and consistently produce great outcomes, regardless of like the circumstances?
Well, you know, at the end of the day, I think the key is not to train them all the same. Everyone's different. The body types are different. The development is different. The understanding of what needs to be done is different. You have to individualize your training based on the individual. And once you understand that, then you got a better chance of being successful. The biggest mistake that trainers make is trying to make everyone the same and try to train them all the same. It's impossible if you want to be successful.
Now, seeing the fact that you have so many huge fights coming up, I have to ask, you know, a few. You know, I know your lineup's crazy,
and
hopefully I can get the orders right, but I know up and coming real soon, you got to fight with Shane Mosley Jr. You're going to be helping him out.
Right.
Can we talk a little bit about how that's going?
Well, it's been great. You know, I've had an opportunity to be with Shane for a few years. I think we're like about four or five years into it now, and he's really worked his ass off to get to where he's at. Now he's ranked in the top 10, something he's never done before. Now having a chance to pursue maybe a title in the next year or so. And it's been great. Shane is going to have a fight here, coming up here soon. He just had a big fight winning, the Continental America's belt.
Mm-hmm.
And so he wants to build on that. And I know that he has the ability. What most people don't realize about Shane is they always compare him to his father, Shane Mosley Sr. But Shane Jr. didn't have a very long amateur career. So a lot of the stuff that he's learning and some of the losses he's taken as a professional, he's learning on the job.
Yeah.
The things that people would have lost learned in the amateurs. So he gets criticized hard, but the kid is super talented. He's really good. And that's part of the reason why I continue to work with him.
You know, and seeing the fact that he had the big win over Gabe Rosado, which many people didn't think he had that.
Yeah.
You know, he looked tremendous in that fight.
Yes.
And then even his opposition he's faced, you know, if he came up short, were people that went fought for world titles and things like that. So his opposition has always been solid. And,
absolutely.
And, you know, and seeing the fact that he's making his own lane, like you said, away from his father.
Yeah.
You're a part of that.
I'm grateful. And to be honest, Dad is still very much in the fold. He comes down for the camps. And you can't get away from Hall of Fame experience and knowledge like his dad brings to the table. So having him there from that standpoint, Bones Adams being his main trainer, but Dad being able to chime in and give great information has been, you know, huge for both of us, not just him.
Now, you know, right after that, you know, a big fight, probably almost to a certain degree of like a fantasy fight where some people didn't think it would happen, but it's here. You know, Caleb Plant, David Benavidez.
Yes.
You know, you've always been working strongly with Caleb Plant, with the big fights from there.
I've been with him 6 years now. Mm-hmm. And before Caleb even became a world champion, he knew this is what he wanted. He knew that this is the spotlight he wanted to be in. He also knew he wanted to etch himself in history as being one of the best to ever do it. And after the Canelo fight, he learned a lot in that fight. There's some things you just got to go through. You know, there are people who could talk about the dark places. Sometimes you just got to go to that dark place to actually get the lessons you need to learn. And I think that's happened for him against Canelo. And now he's taking that experience in, and you saw with Anthony Durrell.
Yeah.
Got a new trainer in Breadman, and that's working really well for him. And so now when this fight was up and Benavidez's opportunity came up, he wanted this fight from before. It just had to make sense, and now it makes sense.
You know, seeing the fact that, you know, from a business standpoint, legacy standpoint, it always made sense to fight Canelo, you know, for Undisputed.
Right.
So the fact that he's fighting David, this was always in the plans, and it was actually probably in the plans when David had the belt at the WBC.
Yep.
So in this case, because it's such a long rivalry built up, has he been planning on fighting like a certain style, certain way in training with you from all the way from the beginning?
No, or? I think that, but of course he had a different trainer then.
Mm-hmm.
And now his dad, Richie Plant, is here full time. And I don't think that it would even be fair to David or to Caleb for him to be trying to figure out what he was going to do back then.
Mm-hmm.
You know, those many, many years ago. I think the only thing that's consistent with what his thought process then and now is he want to have his hand raised at the end. But I think that, you know, him and, you know, David both have, you know, developed over the years. They've both gotten better. And so when you see that night happen, you're going to see two guys who've matured in their process, and you're going to definitely see some fireworks that night, for sure.
You know, seeing that you play a huge pivotal role in the strength and conditioning, we definitely saw a lot of strength in that last fight.
Yes.
Where, you know, we always know he had speed, agility, quickness, timing. Not saying he didn't have power, but, you know, specifically in that fight, I think everyone was amazed by that knockout.
Well, you know, I really wish I could sit here and take all the credit for it. I can't. It's a team effort. We all put our 100% into it, you know, from Richie to myself to Breadman and Caleb as well. There was a lot of things that were adjusted, and at the same time, you know, we all committed to it. So I was awarded this quote-unquote ability to help with that, but it was all of us. We all committed to it.
You know, and going into this fight, you know Caleb best from this. How different is he from the Canelo fight to this fight? Like, is it
not even the same? Only thing that's the same about him is his abilities. Mm-hmm. And they've just gotten better. You know, there's no price tag that you can put on experience. You can't buy it. You can only earn it. And getting in there with one of the best, I mean, we all know Canelo's going to be, he's a Hall of Fame fighter. Mm-hmm. Arguably one of the best in this era. You know, so when you get a guy in the ring with a guy like that, you're going to get a level of experience that no one can talk about. And if you want to talk about being able to manage the spotlight, what bigger stage is there than to be in there with Canelo? You ever been to a Canelo fight? Absolutely. Lights, screaming, fussing, cussing. And he had to endure all of that, and he got something. He learned a lot from that moment. So when Caleb gets in the ring with Benavidez, he's already been here before. This is nothing new to him. He's been there.
And just my overall last question on that topic. You know, I know this is a huge fight, and Caleb's already been involved in big fights, been on pay-per-view more than once.
Right.
So obviously this will be the third time,
right,
second time headlining. Do you think, you know, from the experience that you guys went through and going on pay-per-view will kind of play a little factor in maybe David just taking into that? Like, because Caleb's already been there. Floyd mentioned, like, I'm used to the big lights. It's a lot to adjust to this. It's more than that. Is that going to be maybe something that could affect?
That probably is something David doesn't feel like it's going to affect him. But the reality of it is, like I said before, some things you just got to go through.
Mm-hmm.
And he's never been there. You know, maybe it does well with it. Maybe it doesn't. But that's yet to be seen. And the only way we're going to find out is that night.
Mm-hmm. You know, and then seeing right after that, hopefully I got the order of the amount of fights that you got working. But the next is a next title fight as well. Would it be Marlon?
Marlon.
And he's going to be fighting for not just one, but two titles, the Unified Championship against MJ.
Right.
How did you, you know, link up with Marlon? Were you always working with Marlon for a little bit?
No, you know what? His team reached out to me and asked me if I was willing to work with him. I knew the young man, but I had never worked with him before. They kind of did a relocation to Las Vegas, and they were asking me if I was willing to work with him. I'm saying, absolutely. He's an amazing fighter, and on top of that, he works his ass off. The kid never says no, and no matter how hard I hit him, he smiles the entire time. So who doesn't want an athlete that's willing to do all the hard work and still smile at you at the same time and say, thank you, coach? So that being said, I'm looking forward to it. And he's shown a lot of growth from a power and speed standpoint. And that night, they're going to have to deal with a different guy. He's going to bring a different level of talent and speed and agility to that ring that I don't think most people are ready for.
You know, and seeing the fact that obviously MJ, you know, everyone wanted to see Fulton and MJ face each other. But in this case, would you say Marlon's kind of like the dark horse from like the MJ, the Inoue Fulton? Because, you know, he has a lot of punching power and no one's really talking about him.
Right.
He's fighting. I don't know what the betting odds is, but
I've been here before. You know, I've been in situations like this before where my guy wasn't considered to be, you know, the favorite. I mean, just think about how Caleb Plant got his belt.
Yeah.
You know, Sean Porter got his first belt. You know, so you think about these things and you don't worry about the betting odds. You don't worry about people's opinion. You focus on what's in front of you. And what I have in front of me is an amazing boxer who's working his ass off, who has great talent. And we're going to try to put that all on display that night. And he's going to have to worry about Marlon more so than Marlon worry about him. We already know what he can do. But does he know what Marlon can do?
And, you know, seeing the fact that Marlon does have that punching power.
He does.
And, you know, and MJ does like to move. Mm-hmm. You know, we could possibly see a new unified champion that night.
It's a possibility. It's definitely a possibility. You know, a lot of it has to do with that night, him focusing on what, you know, the game plan is. Because you can have a game plan and someone get hit hard and they change the game plan up in the midstream. So as long as he stays focused and he does what's being asked of him, how it's being asked of him, it's a great chance that he walks away with the with those belts for sure.
You know, and I have to ask from, I guess, because I don't know the body or the strength and condition as well as you do. And in that same division, there's a really intriguing fight as well with the Fulton and Inoue. And Inoue attempting to move up. Technically, I think this would be his fifth weight class he'll be in competing, but it would be his fourth for a title.
Right.
Is Fulton a little too big? Is this too much maybe for Inoue? And when it comes to...
Fulton is special, man. And you know, I can't say enough about him as a boxer. He's definitely a special fighter, and he's going to always give you a show in the ring and out the ring. You want to be able to listen to him. He's an exciting person to watch. And so that night, they're going to really have to deal with a lot that night. And I'm always going to watch a fight, so I'm always going to support him.
Yeah.
He's a great fighter. I love what he does.
You think people, like, obviously, I know there's a lot of hype and attention. Inoue's a great fighter. And to me, I love both fighters equally. But do you feel like there's a slight, like, when it comes to fans that may underestimate what Fulton can do? Just because of the, I guess I'm sure you've heard it, like, the little slight disrespect.
But hasn't that been his whole career, though? Like, no one's ever given him his due anyway.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't have an easy role. People don't realize this kid had to fight all the people that nobody else wanted to fight.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't like he was given some easy push-around, cherry-pick people. No, he had to fight dogs his whole way up. So he has earned the credibility and respect coming from me, and it should be the boxing community, because nothing was given to him.
Yeah.
So I think that he's used to this, and he may even thrive off of this.
Yeah.
I mean, where he's from, they're not used to anything being given to them. So yeah, he's prepared for that, and he understands that, and you're gonna see that night.
I used to make jokes with him, just in a joking way. I was like, "Does Al like you?" Just in a joking way, because he always had that tough road, undefeated fighter,
tough road, right?
You know.
And that's what's, you know what, and that's what makes him special. Once a guy gets that type of callous, that type of veteran experience, it's a lot to deal with. I'm not even talking about athleticism. I'm not even talking about just the boxing ability, but just the IQ and the toughness to be able to get in that ring and do what he does. It's definitely something a lot of people got to deal with.
You know, and going back to what you have to deal with, all these great championship fights on the line. You know, the next one in line after Marlon, if I'm not wrong, but is it the Joe Joyce fight?
Joe Joyce.
With Zillai Zane?
Yes.
And it's just an interim title on the line, or what?
Yeah, he's already interim, but it's always going to be on the line until he gets the fight with Fury. Right now, that fight's not there, but we have to get through this fight first, right?
Mm-hmm.
And hopefully we can get the Fury fight next, but we're not going to look past this guy, because this guy can fight. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to take anything away from him, but when you're talking about a guy like Joe Joyce, this guy's motor is ridiculous. This guy's athleticism is ridiculous. You tell me how many guys, 250, 260 pounds, you know, could do backflips. Exactly.
Can't
he
think
can.
Of right now.
And he can. And one thing he's shown also, he has bricks in both those hands, man.
Absolutely.
And, you know, them hands touch you, barely touch you, your chin, you rocking, right? And then with him having, you know, the IQ of who I consider to be one of the boxing gurus in the sports, and Ismael Salas, it's been wonderful. So anytime I get to partner with Salas, I'm excited,
yeah,
because I can use my experience plus his experience with whomever's in front of us, which we've done now with Robeysi Ramirez as well.
Yeah.
So, yeah, and you didn't mention Robeysi. That's the one you missed.
Is that before or after?
Robeysi's April 1st.
Okay, so Robeysi's before Joyce.
What's up, baby?
Yeah. Yep. You see, this is top level strength and condition right here.
I'm trying my best.
So, just finished up with Joyce and going to Robeysi. You know, when it comes to Joe Joyce, you know, obviously, you know, everyone knows he's a great puncher. Everyone knows he has a great chin.
Right.
When it comes to fighting, you know, Joe Joyce, he possesses, you know, boxing abilities that maybe he doesn't get
respect for.
You know, and it's this fight specifically with Zane, many people thought he won the fight against Phillip.
I was there because Badu Jack was fighting on that card. Mm-hmm. We were in Saudi Arabia, and I did think he won that fight. But, you know, sometimes the judges don't see it the way I see it, and I get it. And we have to accept that's our scoring system. And so now he gets that opportunity to fight, you know, Joe Joyce,
mm-hmm.
which is a great opportunity for him. And I promise you, it's not one that any of us on the team is taking lightly. We understand that guy can fight, but we also understand who's in front of us, too.
Mm-hmm.
We know what Joe Joyce can do. We know his abilities. He's not called a juggernaut for no reason. He is a special, different outlier. What I mean by outlier, there are certain people whose body types do certain things, are supposed to do certain things from a scientific standpoint. He, like some others, like Tyson Fury, live outside of those parameters. They're not normal. The testing doesn't put them in being a normal category. They're outside of that. And that's what part of the reason that makes them special.
And I mentioned special, Orbisi Ramirez, obviously with the gold medal coming over. I know he had
two.
Two gold medals.
Yeah.
And, you know, and in addition to, I know that in the beginning he had his pro debut hiccup.
Right.
But he overcame that, and now he's been on a tear.
Yeah.
A crazy knockout
right.
over, you know, Nova, who had a great performance recently
right.
as well.
Right.
You know, he's fighting Isaac Dogbe.
I'm happy to see Nova back.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that was a really rough fight for, you know, Nova, but he put up a great fight, and he lost to a great fighter. So he should not hold his head down by any shape, form, or fashion. Even for his last fight, I supported him, and I was going to comment and say congratulations, but you just never know how a guy takes it. He may think I'm trying to be, you know, slick and insult him, but I'm still a fan of him. I'm still a supporter of him. But basically, I've been with him now going on 2 years, and he's been knocking everybody out since we've been together.
Yeah.
And so now, you know, I'm just happy that he's earned this opportunity now to fight for, you know, potential title now that Navarrete's vacated. We might have a chance to get that world title now with Dogbe. And if that happens, then this is what this was all about, to be able to give him that opportunity.
You know, seeing the fact that Dogbe has been in the ring with Navarrete, and I'll move towards that. But obviously, this fight is obviously a huge fight. Former champion, you know, he's slick, you know, he's strong, you know, he has the chance, a lot of energy. You know, would you say this is Robisi's toughest fight coming professionally, or it's just
I don't know. I mean, it's hard to say. You won't know till that night. You know, Dogbe's been a lot of fights, and, you know, some hard ones, been fighting for a long time. You just don't know which guy's gonna show up.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it may be the A-level guy or the A-minus guy. You're not gonna get anything less than A-minus because he's that caliber of fighter. But I can say this, that I believe Dogbe understands that the guy in front of him is a huge talent, and it's gonna be a lot to deal with that night. But I can promise you, basically gonna be ready. He's gonna be ready for it. He's been waiting for this. So we're excited about the fight. We're in camp right now.
You know, and obviously, a great fight would be Navarrete and Robisi, you know. Seeing the fact, I'm just being a little, you know, fun matchmaking hype, but like...
If you're going to go that far, you might as well say Robisi and Shakur again if you're going to go that far.
Well, I mean, you know,
that's way too far away. What's he now, 35?
Well, I didn't bring...
Robisi 26?
Well, that's why I didn't bring up Shakur for any specific reason.
I'm like, that's too far.
I think he said, like... Shakur's grown and out of the weight.
Absolutely.
I didn't bring it up. You brought it up.
But I mean, they're already growing out too.
Yeah. I mean, to a certain degree, though, like, I guess his last performance.
That Brandon's a big guy, though.
Yeah.
He's a big guy. He's just sizing down. He's a big guy.
But that would be a great fight, though. Would you think, though?
And down the line. You know, you know, he did his thing at 26, and, you know, we respect that. Definitely respect that, you know, but now Robisi gets his opportunity to do his thing at 26.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where the focus is at. We're not thinking about 30. We're not thinking about 35. We want to be able to make an impact at 26. And if we can make an impact at 26, maybe down the line, years later, we could think about 30 or these fun matchups. But we're still establishing ourselves. You know, we're not in a space where we can say, you know what, let's go have this fun fight. No, let's get these belts first. And then... You know, down the line, maybe that's something he and the manager and promotion and everyone can come up with it. My job is just to train. That's it.
But Robisi's been looking really damn good.
He has.
So it's kind of, I guess, maybe part of the fandom or just the boxing fans kind of seeing how great and how talented that
yes.
he could probably possess those type of attributes.
Absolutely. And I would love to say that this was my thought process. It wasn't. Each fight, Robisi and I and the team sat and talked and Ismael Salas as well, and Robisi let us know, I'm knocking him out. Each person he knocked out, he told us he was knocking him out before the fight started.
Mm.
I'm knocking him out. And I'm like, okay. You know, and so we let him box, and then he knocks people out. At the end of the day, he understands what he understands the tools he has, and he also understands how to use them. It's not my place to tell him how to do it. It's my place to get him prepared to do it, you know?
And then overall, my last fight that I believe on record you have, another championship fight ending in all, is it?
Jay Bonet.
Okay.
And he had a world title fight coming. Well, in theory, we haven't got it. It looks likely.
Yeah.
You know, he's ranked number one in the world right now.
Mm-hmm.
So he's going to be fighting here soon. And so he is a special fighter. I don't think enough people know about him yet, but they will. He reminds me of I ain't gonna say tough for Manny Pacquiao, because Manny is definitely a tough guy. But this kid, I've seen him just start walking guys down where maybe I didn't see that as much with Manny. Manny definitely was knocking guys out, but it wasn't from a walk down standpoint. He was doing his moves, jump in, hit him with a combination, the guy go down. I've seen this guy multiple times just stop with all the bouncing and just start walking them guys down and hurting them. And that's a different twist for stylistically, you know, for the smaller fighters. So I think he has a great opportunity to be a big impact. And he has, you know, Marlon Tapatas is one of the top guys as well, both ranked number one in the world. They get to train together in the gym. They get to train together on the track. They get to train together in sparring, which I think has helped both guys.
And then before I let you go, there's this great podcast that I got to watch. I know you're kind of brushed up, but I just had to insert, you know, Wading Through the BS.
Yeah, Wading Through the BS is my podcast.
And you had some nice cool stuff with Jordan Plant, Caleb Plant, right, things like that. Can you just end it with just, you know, the podcast? You know, you do it on the side, but, you know.
Well, I started the podcast for a number of reasons, because in boxing, a lot of time people think they know the answers or they think things to be true. And I like, most of the time, that's some bullshit. Like, it's bullshit. Don't listen to everything, right? So, with my last name being Wade, I said, why don't I come up with a podcast that says Wading Through the Bullshit? But instead of saying bullshit, I put BS, right? And it gives me to have these people that they see on TV, the real boxers, the real entertainers, and have a conversation about things that they think they may know, but get a more of an insight on who the people they look up to, their stars. And also insight on me and my relationship with them. And that's been so much fun so far. And I mean, when I say fun, I think I enjoy shooting it much more than I like presenting and put it online.
Yeah, it's work.
But it's so much fun doing it, though, you know. So, no, I've been blessed, and I'm grateful that I've been able to do it. And maybe one day I get to put you on there.
Oh, no. I'm a cool guy. I'm behind the camera.
Everybody's cool, for sure.
Well, I appreciate the opportunity to do
a great interview.
And social media or anything.
Keep supporting the sport. Boxing is an amazing sport. Without the fans, we have nothing. And we appreciate everything you do. I appreciate you guys supporting me as an entrepreneur, strength conditioning coach, motivational speaker, podcast guy, and whatever other descriptions you have for me. Thank you for that as well. So if you don't mind continuing to support me, go to Coach Larry Wade on every social media platform. And hopefully you'll get a chance to participate on some of that and see some of the fights that you guys want to see. You'll see me with a lot of those guys.
Awesome. Appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Thank you, guys.